And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. Thank you, God. That is our heart's cry as the bride of Christ in this place, that God, that you would come and pour out your Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that we're just traveling through this world, that our citizenship is with you in the heavenlies. As we journey, Lord, we daily get thirsty. So we ask that you'd pour out your presence and that we would experience you this morning. Because of your grace, Lord, may you break through our pride and our arrogance, our fear. Give us the courage to drop our pointing finger and fix our eyes on Jesus in this place. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. You may be seated. Gospel of John, chapter 7, the scripture says, on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and he cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scriptures has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. What a scene that must have been there in the courtyards of the temple. It says, on the eighth day, the greatest day of the Feast of Tabernacles. This is the end of the celebration where for 7 days the priest would go to the pool of Siloam. It means sent one. And they would take these seven jars and fill them with water and pour it out on the ground of the temple, recognizing that their journey from Egypt to the promised land, God provided water from a rock. And they would do this for 7 days until the eighth day, where they would come and they would go to the pool of Siloam and come back with empty jars. And as they would tip over their jars with no water in them, the priests would read from Isaiah 44, for I will pour water on him who is thirsty and floods on the dry ground, and I will pour my spirit on your descendants and my blessing on your offspring. This is what was taking place as the priest would pour out these jars with nothing in. Dual meaning. It was saying no longer do we need water from the rock because we've entered into the promised land, but it was also saying we're still looking for the sent one, Siloam. As a priest read the scripture, this is where Jesus got up and cried out loud, we just read, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. What a scene. And offering a gift from the Father, his divine presence. This is where a nation remembered their heritage, remembered their history, a time where they were enslaved in Egypt for 430 years. You can really learn a lot by looking at the past. This is exactly what they were doing, remembering where the journey began and where it partially ended. Yesterday morning, I was repenting of some things of my past, particularly selfishness. And the Lord spoke to me and said, Dave, look back, just don't go back. Oh man, I chewed on that all day. I can look back and I can learn and remember who I was, and it's not who I am by the grace of God. But I can't look back at who I was as it's who I still am. Because when you do that, what happens is you won't look back because it's just too painful, you see. The Jews were looking back to learn something, but they weren't moving forward. Today, if you're willing to be with me for the next 45 minutes, stay with me. Have a heart to receive what the Holy Spirit is saying. Don't check out because you think you've heard something or you figured it out or you're already good. Stay tuned in. It's easy on a journey to get distracted and get tired and stop paying attention. Car accidents happen that way. I want you guys to arrive at a destination of blessing today. When you're on a journey, you know where you're coming from, you know where you're going, and you're paying attention to how you're getting there. This is kind of what the nation of Israel was doing. Looking back at Exodus chapter 12, the beginning of the journey, the scripture says, God called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, "Rise, go out from among my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also." And then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 men on foot besides children. So you've roughly got 3 million estimated Jews. 650,000 men, but when you add women and children, you've roughly got 3 million. That's going to be Moses' new congregation. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, on that very same day, it came to pass that all the armies of the Lord went out of the land of Egypt. After 430 years of slavery, it's jubilee, it's freedom. It's getting something that you could never earn. It wasn't like the Jews were praying and fasting and holding synagogue. They were in bondage. They were bitter. They were jaded. They were orphans, in a sense. I did some research on what was this nation like, and three different sources, and of course, it's somewhat of a guess. No one was there, but the average lifespan of a slave, a Jewish slave in ancient Egypt, was 30 years old. In other words, this is not a real huge demographic of age. This is, well, if you would, 3 million millennials. If the average age is 30, you've got a lot of young slaves. Now, you see, understand the dynamic. This is a group of people who were, they didn't have Sabbath. They didn't have vacations. They didn't have a sick day. You got a whip day, but not a sick day, right? So the lifespan of being treated like a slave was a low lifespan. Now, that gives you some concept of how this started. This is really important. We're going to come back to this dynamic. But there's a reason why us as New Testament saints look back at this journey. We could do a whole series on the journey in the wilderness, has everything to do with you and me in our walk with Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, "I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact," or ignorant, lacking knowledge. I don't want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank from the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them. That rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Last week, we looked at Matthew 11, where Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." It was an invitation to a nation who still wasn't getting it. They were practicing the feasts, which were shadows and invitations and object lesson sermons, if you would, of what God promised he was going to do, and in their very presence, he was actually doing. Now, the scripture says, the Apostle Paul's insight was, God was not pleased. In other words, they weren't getting the lesson. Maybe you've tried to teach someone something, maybe one of your kids, and it's just like dropping seed on concrete. They're just not getting it. And the Pharisees weren't either. Jesus said, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, and they're concerned about bread. They just weren't getting it, right? The lessons were incredible. Here's just a couple stops after he freed them from Egypt, which, understand, that's a picture of you and I getting freed from our sins. Egypt's type of the world, a bondage, a slavery to sin. You know, what I don't want to do, I keep doing. The things I want to do, I don't do. Who will rescue me from this body of death, this slavery? This is the way Israel was for 430 years, you see. And he delivered them and began then to teach them, at least attempt to. And each time he had them have a rest stop on their journey from Egypt to Jordan, or the promised land. See, that's you and I. We got rescued. We were born again in the spirit, and now we're on this journey in this wilderness of sin. And God's trying to teach us the same thing he was teaching them, that we'll never get through the journey without grace. We'll never get to our destination without getting what we don't deserve. The first place he had them stop was Sukkoth. It means tent town. The lesson was, hey, don't root in here in this world. You're just passing through. It's an important thing to learn on your journey. Sometimes people go from A to B, and on the way, they're like, this is a nice place to live. Let's kind of look around. Just get to your destination, you know. And God was trying to say to his people, you're just passing through. Your citizenship is not on earth, it's in heaven. Sukkoth means tent town. You're just temporarily pitching a tent here, and you're going to be leaving. That's you and I. Aren't you gloriously joyful that this is not our home? Hallelujah. It's like, as I see it, just continuing like a toilet spirally going down, right? It's not our home. Sukkoth. The next place was Etham, means with you. God says, hey, as you're journeying, I want you to know you're in Etham. I'm with you on this journey. And he was. Cloud by day, fire by night. We read of this rock that followed them around that somehow got water from a rock. God cracks me up, right? But he wanted them to know that he was with them. And then he took them to the Red Sea, the place that I like to call the place between a rock and a hard place, where he had two mountains, a sea, and an army with nuclear weapons, pretty much equivalent to what it was of the day, and you can't do anything to rescue yourself. You know what you need? Grace. You need favor from God that you don't earn. I mean, it's not like they earned it. They were slaves. They couldn't buy it. They couldn't purchase it. But after he rescued them, then he took them to a place called Marah, which means bitter. Can you imagine traveling through the desert and going, oh, finally some water. What was the lesson? Well, the lesson was, hey, you see that branch over there? Apply that branch to the water. It's going to make Marah sweet. Apply the work of the cross to your bitter roots and watch God transform it. They didn't get that lesson. Eliam means mighty ones. That was a rest stop that was amazing. They were severing palm trees and 12 wells. And the sixth one was the wilderness of sin, where they were hungry and looking to go back to Egypt and have an onion and garlic sandwich and just messing all the finer dining of Egypt. And God brings that, just this cakes from heaven. And they called it manna, which we looked at last week in the Hebrew, means, what is it? I can't explain what it is. It's kind of like grace. It makes no sense that God would give us anything. At least I hope you think that way. And he's trying to teach them that I saved you by grace. I'm leading you to a wonderful place because of grace. And I'm with you on the whole journey because of grace. And I'm going to deliver you from all your enemies because of grace. I'm going to feed you because of grace, and they didn't get it. It's hard to accept something freely, like, but I have to earn this. I don't deserve this. Yeah, that's the point. Jesus looked at this nation that was pouring out empty jars as if they don't need water from a rock anymore. And he says, come unto me, all you are weary and heavy laden. Oh my gosh, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's the heart of a good shepherd. He just sees a flock that's still traveling. You crossed over the Jordan, you're in the promised land, but you're still really parched. And you're still trying to earn my attention and my favor. And do you know a relationship with God doesn't work like that? And I'm so grateful for that, aren't you? You know, we looked at Mary and Martha with Lazarus. Man, they were grumbling, complaining, doubting, still got their miracle. You know, after the crucifixion, you know, the crucifixion, you see the disciples in a room locked in fear, not praying and fasting and holding rallies. They're in fear, and he shows up. His manifest presence shows up. You know why? Grace. God is good. And he's not good to respond to us because we're being good. He's just good because he's good. And that's what that journey was all about. That's why you read, as we read Hebrews 4 last week. If you weren't here, rest for the weary. I encourage you to check it out and pray through that word. We looked at Hebrews 4, where the writer of Hebrews says, they didn't get it. They missed the whole point of grace. So today, if you hear his voice in the desert, don't harden your hearts like they did if you hear the Holy Spirit. I'm still learning how to hear that voice that says rest and grace. You can't do it. You need help. And God is constantly bringing you and I lessons that are humbling and they're painful. They hurt. I had such a lesson this last Tuesday evening that was traumatic even, I would say. Kathy and I got home, and she's been gone for 6 days. I'm still recovering from that too. Yeah. Tony says, amen. You're with me, brother. Yes. We came in and spent some time with our flock here and the staff and went and had dinner, spent a little time catching up, and then we went home. And as I'm sitting on the chair, my dog, Gracie, this is my dog, Gracie, by the way, because some of you don't know one of my kids, and so that's my little girl, and that's her sitting with her head on my knee, because that's what she does every morning as I have my Christian beverage called coffee. It is. Hebrews. Get it? Hebrews. Anyway, so I had to have my coffee. She just sits there every morning, and so I love this dog. I mean, it's crazy. I've always been a dog person, but as some of you know the story, I won't go through the whole thing with you today, but this dog grabbed my heart in 24 hours in a way I've never loved a dog so much. She's my friend, right? But she did something Tuesday night as I'm sitting there on the couch that I didn't really like. She projectile vomited. Yeah. I'm like, oh, no. Kathy. Yeah. Those type of excretions and sanctifying moments, I have a wife who's happy to serve. And I'm thankful for that. That connects with my prayer, forgive me for selfishness previously, but that's another story. So Kathy's coming in, she's cleaning, she's just going all over the house. And then she goes in her cage and we're sitting there and she's just not herself. And then all of a sudden she gets up out of her cage and starts to walk and she collapses. And then she starts to have a seizure, multiple seizures. And as you can imagine, we're like upset. And she weighs 85 pounds. And I'm laying there, and as soon as she started seizing, she's going to the bathroom. As she's laying there, she can't hold her bowels. She's a mess. She's crashing. And so I'm like, we need to get to a hospital, like now. And Kathy's getting the records. I'm trying to pick her up, and I cannot. I can pick up 85 pounds, but when you've got an 85-pound puppy that is seizing, I just couldn't pick her up. And I'm sitting there trying to pick this dog up, seizing, and I can't, and she's dying. And it was terrible. I just didn't know what to do, because I've tried and I've tried. Every time I start to pick her up, she just comes back to the ground. And Kathy's going, I'll go get a neighbor. I'm like, we don't have time for that. And I said, this is what we'll do is I rolled her, I crossed my legs like this, like an Indian, and I rolled her in my lap, and then I got in a squat position. I said, now, Kathy, and she's having seizures, and I said, I want you to come up and put your hands up under my arms, and when I say go, help me get up. And sure enough, we're up, and we're out the door. And it was such, as I'm driving, running red lights and thanking God for grace, I'm just like, wow, if she wouldn't have helped me, I couldn't get her up. It was killing me, right? I couldn't get her up. And I'm realizing I need help. I can't do this on my own. You know, man, isn't that life, right? I mean, it's just like, but I'm a 200-pound man. I can't pick up an 85-pound dog. I got to ask my wife to help me? Yeah. I need help. God put me in a humbling experience, and I had no problem humbling myself at that moment. And this is the scripture that came to mind, the Apostle Paul. Oh, I love this. Asking God to remove a weakness in his life, he said, the Lord spoke to him and said, my grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Paul says, therefore, most gladly I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and needs and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, come on, church, then I am strong. Wow. It's like, but it's no fun going down that journey. It's no fun having that moment, that appointment in life where it's traumatic and there's great loss and pain, and you're like, I am helpless to feed myself. I'm helpless to protect myself. I'm helpless to figure out this problem. I can't fix my marriage. I can't change the doctor's report. I can't do anything. Now, we start our journey like that, but we get self-assured as time goes by. Unfortunately, the Apostle Paul, man, he knew better. I love his word in 1 Corinthians 15. If you can't tell, I like the scriptures a lot. Amen. Faith comes by hearing, right? He says, 1 Corinthians 15, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. By the grace of God, I am what I am. This is a guy who was like super apostle, not the super apostles that claim to be super apostle. He really was. Like, what a powerful man of God. But he recognized, he says, but by the grace of God. Now, he also said, I'm the chief of sinners. I'm the worst sinner out there. There's nobody more of a sinner than me, Paul says. But I can separate what I am in my flesh to who I am in the spirit because of the finished work of Christ. I am what I am because of the grace of God. And the thing is, if you think you've learned that, how about we change that to we're learning that, because we learn it and then we unlearn it. It's kind of like we got it on the desktop, but then on the journey, we're out of Egypt, but Egypt comes back out of the hard drive and pushes grace off the desktop. You know, you could take us out of the world, but the world's still kind of in us. Yeah, that's the need for sanctification, which comes by grace, right? That's what this journey was all about. And in Exodus 17 was their seventh rest stop. All right, it says Exodus 17, verse 1, then all the congregation of the children of Israel sent out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin according to the commandment of the Lord and camped in Rephidim. You know what Rephidim means? Rest stop. In other words, they're in their wilderness, and they've been through a lot. We've been through those other six stops. They've been through some serious roller coaster rides. And the Lord says, time for a rest stop. Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Now, that doesn't sound like a good rest stop. right? Like, you're on the wilderness journey. It's dry. You're parched. And God says, time for a rest stop. I found this sign here, a picture. I liked it a lot. Check this out. Rest area, God's grace. Amen? It's like, it's not water, it's not food, it's not counseling, it's not a sermon, it's not a worship service. It's just this unseen, spiritual, intravenous grace from God that's called power. See, a lot of people think grace, well, grace just means that God's forgiven my sin and no matter what I do, I'm okay. That's not grace. Grace is power from God to be justified. Grace is power from God to have position with God that you can't earn or merit. Grace is power from God to go and sin no more. Grace is a gift from God. And God says, you're going to need rephidim. You're going to need rest stop. You're going to need a lot of stops to get grace. And when you do so, look back for grace, but don't go back because then you're going under law. Which is unfortunately what we do sometimes. Now, I don't know about you, but there's been times I've been on a journey from A to B, and rest stop is not just water. It's not just what you're taking in, it's what you're getting out. And there's nothing worse when you stop at a rest stop and you go, and it says, you read this sign, out of order. And if you're a guy, no problem. You're looking for a tree. If you're a woman, you're asking your husband to start speeding, right? Rest stop. God's got that worked out. What do you do when you get an alert? You say, God, I need your grace, right? When you come to a rest stop, family, it's about taking in and it's about getting rid of. You follow me? When God says about rest stop, there's things that he wants to give you and there's things he wants you to let go of. That was part of the journey in the wilderness. It's like, I want you to let go of Egypt and your appetite for Egypt, and I want you to drink in freely what I have to give you. That's what rephidim really is all about. Check out Exodus chapter 17, verse 2. It says, therefore the people contended with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. So Moses said to them, why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, why is it you have brought us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst? There is a need for purging. There is something inside this group of 3 million young people that they need to let go of. Now, I want you to understand the dynamics, because I've never really thought about this until the last couple of days. God's, like I said, got a sense of humor. He's going to take this group of 3 million, let's call it the largest young adult ministry you've ever heard of on planet Earth. Whom shall I have lead them? He picks an 80-year-old guy. An 80-year-old guy named Moses. I think that's hilarious. Not only is he like geritol old, and you're not old if you don't know what geritol is, by the way. Okay, he's an old guy, but not only is he old, he's a deserter. See, at the age of 40, he realized he was a Jew, not an Egyptian, treated like an Egyptian, prince of Egypt. Matter of fact, he was set to take over and be the next pharaoh, found out he was a Jew, killed an Egyptian. And then he's a fugitive, and he takes off into the country and lives there as a shepherd, which a shepherd to an Egyptian was like someone who empties septic tanks. Disgusting. And that's what he does from the age of 40 to 80, because God is cultivating Moses' heart to be aligned with his own. That took 40 years. So maybe you're not so slow after all. Right? So for, at the age of 80, he sees that bush burning that's not consumed. Now, we all want to see a bush that's burning and not consumed, and we all want to be on fire, but do you think that maybe just those tedious days of just caring for sheep and doing what you might call monotonous and pointless, that it's God removing lies and guilt and shame and old identity because he wants to make room for a new one? And without that, you'll never see the burning bush? Maybe God knows what he's doing. What do you think? Right? So he takes his 80-year-old guy and says, I'm going to use Moses to lead this group of 3 million people with an average lifespan of 30 to a time that's going to be tough. And Moses, I'll use you as a leader, and I'm going to have you do and say things and lead these people to places that they're going to want to crucify you over. Who wants to be a leader? Who wants to be a pastor? Who wants to be a shepherd? Can you imagine being Jeremiah, the prophet? I'm going to use you to tear down, overthrow, destroy before you ever plant and build. Man. I'm convinced that pastor, shepherd, leader in the Greek means scapegoat. You know, because Moses is like, he's like, why are you contending with me? Like, what's the tension between my leadership and you following? They're coming and saying, your intention was to kill us. You led us out here to kill us? Now, see, they weren't talking like that after the parting of the Red Sea, where it was the largest beachside night of worship you've ever heard in history. Man, everyone's thrilled then. They're like, this is awesome. This is great, man. The Spirit of God's moving. Miriam, man, you got that tambourine thing going on. And Moses, I had no idea you could write music. This, I mean, everyone's so gifted. This is so wonderful. Hallelujah. Raise a hallelujah, right? What? How did they get from, well, this was already in them. It's kind of like when you do the church hop and man, this is just the best place in the world. And, oh, man, the Spirit of God and the Word and the people. And, Mara. Bitter. Rephidim. Rest stop. You let us hear and it's just dried up. Where's the Spirit of God moving? When I read this and I saw something I never saw before between the age gap between Moses and the average lifespan of one of these 3 million people, I thought of a movie that most of us in this room have probably seen, which is The Jesus Revolution. If you've seen it, just raise your hand just so I've got an idea. Okay, more than half. Here's a picture of one shot that really, I caught my eye when I watched the movie. I loved it, right? And I go, I mean, and just so you know, I grew up Calvary Chapel. You know, it's like I grew up just loving the history I had and learning about what God did in the Jesus movement in the 70s. I had the fortunate opportunity to have a dinner with Chuck one time, and he was the same guy in person as he was in the pulpit, and just the real deal. You know, love the Lord, humble, no-nonsense guy, and just love, 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 you know? And so I had a real excitement to watch this movie with my roots at Calvary, and I saw this. This was the church. In the beginning of the movie, if you remember, there was just a few people in there. Everyone, you know, dressed up and looking beautiful, and you couldn't tell if it was a church or a morgue, right? But then when, of course, his daughter, which was the actress there on your far left is his daughter. She just found this hippie hitchhiking and brought him home and said, Dad, you know, pretty much this is going to help you with your dead church, you know? And so this guy, Lonnie, starts bringing his friends. And this is what really blew me away, where I go, look at Egypt. This young group that is like going, man, we're hungry. make love, not war. Looking in the wrong places, but they're ready to like seek Jesus and say, we're just reckless and abandonment. We don't care about the system and make and conforming to what tradition says we have to be. We just want, we want chains broken, right? And God brings this group of hippies, what they were called in, to the church. And then you've got this group of older people, the Moses generation, on the left side, right? And so, can I show you a clip from the movie? Would you like to see that? Okay, check this clip out. Let's play that.
I want you all to look at me. Please. Every one of you. This place, it is yours. I don't care if anybody else thinks so. I mean, if you feel like you're an outcast, then join us here. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, this is where you belong. If you feel ashamed or trapped in something you've done or are doing, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here. No guilt trips. This is your home. And I want you to tell all your friends about it. There is a place for you. Now that door is open all the time for you, any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door is open for you too. It works both ways.
Let's begin.
Let's begin.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Such a great scene, right? When I watched that, this verse came to mind in 1 Peter. It says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You are a chosen generation, not generations. One. See, for so many years, decades, I looked at the Jesus movement. I go, yeah, it was God, you just used the hippies. And no. First of all, the Jesus movement revival was all the Holy Spirit. It was all him moving, but he used the hippies, in our case, the millennials, but he equally used Moses' generation. It was both. The gospel lifts up a relationship between a father and a son. It's beautiful. Jesus came to show us, to introduce us, reintroduce us, reconnect us to the Father. One, the Father and I are one. I long to see that today. I'm asking, Father, what is the break? What was the break between Chuck's generation and Greg Laurie's generation? What was the break between Moses' generation and the generation that was freed from Egypt? Because they're two different ones. What's the break between my generation and millennials today? It's the same problem. And there's only one cure. It's the grace of God. I am what I am by the grace of God. See, what took place in Chuck's day is, and this is what happens to my generation, is the grace of God that we enjoyed when we began our journey, we don't impart to those that are beginning theirs. We compensate with control and judgment. If you watch the movie, Chuck was going, oh, these hippies, they need a bath. The people that were watching come to the church, oh, they're getting sand all over the carpet. They're messing our agenda up. And our idea of what pleases God, it sounds like the Pharisees, doesn't it? Do you think Chuck knew he was sounding like a Pharisee? No. And for the last 10 plus years, neither did I. I thought I was just protecting an atmosphere that so we don't quench the Holy Spirit. And not that that's a bad thing, but the enemy comes in and his agenda is to split generations instead of them work together, which was really the tip of the spear for the Jesus movement, where you had a Chuck and a Greg Laurie. We need help. Because what happens is, as you have this generation who says, we loved the grace of God when we were a mess, walking around in metaphorical diapers when we began our walk with Jesus, and the grace we had with the mess we made, we don't impart that. And see, this is what happens on the other side, the response to the younger generation, the generation who's hungering for that grace of God and to see it modeled through spiritual fathers and mothers. They're dying for it. Because that's our job, is to represent the Father. The father of the prodigal son represented God. It was a literal story, and he represented God properly, didn't he? When we don't, what happens to that younger generation that is hungering to be fathered and mothered, what happens is they get jaded and they contend with Moses. Was it Moses' fault the way things were? No. Was it Moses' wrong leadership? No, but Moses definitely had some wrong attitudes as this people, Egypt, was being worked out of that younger generation. He'd pray prayers like, God, why did you put me with these people? Why did you just kill me? That would be the wrong attitude to have, don't you think? You ever had that attitude with a younger generation? And here's the thing, a lot of the times, not always, but a lot of times, the older generation is right. That younger generation is full of zeal, lacking in wisdom and experience, but they compensate for a zeal and an adventurous risking of faith and jumping out that just counterbalances and supplements, but they're not walking in the wisdom. That's why Solomon said, listen, my son, and attain wisdom. So what happens, the younger generation who's hungering to see the grace modeled through spiritual fathers and mothers, what happens is they just write off those fathers and spiritual mothers as a generation who's lost. We're the lost generation, and it's true. We're both lost, and only God can help us, and he wants to help us through each other. The mutual blessing of the gift of God that comes through the Moses generation and the Exodus generation is an expression of God that brings revival. Because love and grace and mercy, man, it's the platform in which God heralds the gospel, you see. Can what happened in Chuck's generation with the hippies happen with my generation, with the millennials? Yes, absolutely. Can we stop this bitter pointing of the fingers as the older generation, you guys are irresponsible, you're flaky, you know, all the things that you've heard said about you? And can you guys stop and saying, well, you guys are just not free and you're not moving in the spirit and you're trying to control us, even though a lot of it's true? There's not the grace from the older generation to practice a love that's patient, and there's not the grace in the younger generation because they were looking to the older generation to see it, and since they didn't, they got jaded and had judgment and bitter roots, and now they're not receiving something and shooting themselves in the foot. The younger generation will say, I don't receive that, Pastor. You don't see the Spirit of God's moving in power in our younger group. Well, here's the thing. The Spirit of God was moving in power in the church of Corinth too. But that didn't mean that they were on track, right? We want something more than just a localized expression. We want to see an outpouring, a torrent of living water coming from the body of Christ through a generation. And the thing is, you have to be intentional. Chuck was intentional, and he took risks of getting a judgment, didn't he? Peter took risks. He was intentional. I'm going to go to Cornelius' house. It's not right. It's not even as enjoyable for me. They're not going to serve the food that I can eat. It's not my thing. That's why I loved so much Bus 36 in Israel. We had a group of 36 people spending 2 weeks together. I mean, from people in their 80s to teenagers. And it was just, when we first got on the bus, it was kind of like, okay. You know, and you can always, when you do that, you can always watch the group of people. Okay, 20 to 30, that's your group, right? Senior citizens, that group. Middle-aged people, kids have teenagers, that group. The white group, the black group, the Hispanic group. And we're so segregated, aren't we? What's it going to take? And take a humbling, man. This verse, you'll like this. This is a zinger. James 4:6. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Wow, that's a good word. But it's not indigenous to our nature to humble ourselves. It's almost like you're gonna be put in Rephidim, put in a place that you would never take yourself in a situation. Like, I didn't really come to be with this particular group of people. I came for Israel. But the Holy Spirit's saying, yeah, but I brought you here for this group. I brought you here for something much bigger than Israel. I brought you here to have the 80-year-old talk with a 16-year-old and pray together and love each other and listen and both love the grace of God for wherever you're at in your journey. And if the younger generation can benefit from the wisdom and experience and humble sharings of a journey from an older generation, praise God. If an older generation has become crusty and cobwebbed and prehistoric in their faith and not stepping out in faith, not taking risks anymore, riding off events of the past. And because you're so unhappy, hence you fall into judgment to the younger generation for taking risks and being a little messy. As the proverb says, a clean barn has no profits. Things are going to be messy. That's okay. Better messy and moving forward and growing. That's how Jesus thought about it when the 30-year-old says to a bunch of teenagers, come follow me and I will make you fishermen of men. What did Moses do? He does what all good leaders do. Verse 4, it says that he cried out to the Lord. That's what you do. He cried out to the Lord, what shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said to Moses, go on before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel. Also take in your hand the rod which with you struck the river and go. Now, keep in mind, that rod, that was a rod that he struck the river, of course, with the Red Sea, but it was also the rod that turned into a serpent. It's symbolic of power. The rod of God, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me, right? The power of God. Take the power of God in your hand, Moses. Behold, and I will stand before you there on the rock of Horeb, and you shall strike the rock and the water till it comes out of it, and the people may drink. Who could not think of John 19 where the scripture says, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. This was a picture of grace and redemption and forgiveness, and love covers a multitude of sin. And only his grace is sufficient. And in your weakness, he is strong. In your poverty, he'll make you rich. Like it was an invitation to drink in the water of life freely. Beautiful. For who? Everyone. Old and young, male and female, Jew, Gentile, slave, Greek or free, one chosen generation, all drinking from the same rock, the same spirit. I'm so grateful heaven will be just like that, aren't you? Man, so how do we do that? How do we take the rod of God and experience this water of life that Jesus says, are you thirsty? Come unto me. It's called grace. Rephidim, rest stop. It's not just your Sabbath, man. It's every day. It could. I cannot tell you how many Rephidim stops I have every day. Going, Lord, I need your grace. I don't know what to do. I'm upset. I felt this way over the last week with Gracie, my dog, in case you didn't know how apropos. Her name, Gracie. Because when we rushed her to the emergency room, her liver count was 285, basically 100 above what's normal. She's ingested something that's some type of toxin. We don't know. And they can't get a pulse, no blood pressure. She had seizures the whole drive there, and that's just unheard of. When a dog has seizures more than a few minutes, it's not good. And she was seizing for half an hour. And so we get there, and as you can imagine, we're pretty torn up, and this doctor is cruel to us the way he's talking to us. First, he's trying to whack us with a bill that I got to pull out a kidney to sell just to get her to keep her there for the night. And he was cruel the way that he talked to us. And as I'm listening to this, because it was some misunderstanding, we asked for, instead of a 24-hour quote, a 12-hour quote, because the 24 was like $3,500. And like, can you do a 12-hour? And we go to the front desk, and they said, sure, go sit down in the room. And he comes back, and he says, I'm taking the catheter out of your dog. We're not doing this. What are you talking about? I don't have time for this. I'm not playing games with you. I have other emergencies. I got second things to do. We're heartbroken. I'm like, Lord, please, please. I don't want to punch this man. I don't, you know. But, and you, Pastor, you thought that? Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is called keeping it real, right? I want to get up and deck this guy. Like, you don't, and it's not even so much for me. It's because you're crushing my wife at a time of trauma, and I'm ready to lay you out. And by the grace of God, I am what I am. Right? We worked it out. We left to go home, and long story short, ends up we need to go back to get her. We take her to the vet the next day, a local vet, and her liver count goes from 285 to 2200. She's in liver failure. Liver failure. And hence I wasn't here Wednesday night. So we've been through a lot, ups and downs. I'm going, God, it's just a dog. My gosh, it's just a dog. It's killing me. She's my friend. And I'm laying hands on my dog and asking God to heal her liver because I'm like, we need help, right? And we picked her up yesterday morning. We've been seeing her every day. And it went down from 2,200 to 1,400 to 114, totally normal. Yeah, right? How cool is that, right? Now,
He says, she's still not out of the woods yet. Please pray for my dog. Pray for Gracie, okay? You know, and so she's still not herself. She's not feeling well, but it's been just constant Kathy and I going, okay, Lord, we need grace from you. You ready? To trust you. With whatever happens, to trust you. Grace is not power to get God to do what you want to do when you want him to do it. Grace is to accept that God will use infirmities and difficulties and 12 wells of refreshment, 70 palm trees, or Mara, or Rephidim, where there's nothing. He'll use it all. And grace is being able to trust God and say, you're God, and I accept good and bad as I would deem them, knowing it's all good with you because you're always good. And I need grace constantly, don't you? And the only thing that's going to take this contending and this contention away and bring an upper room unity between multiple generations that are biological and showcase spiritually one generation, like Bus 36 in Israel, is all of us looking to the same rock. All of us looking to the same grace of God that we began the journey with, that we can't complete the journey without, right? If I asked you one example in the Bible of what's grace, what do you think? This is what grace is. All of us could come with different answers, but I'm going to give you mine. Luke chapter 23, the scripture says, then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed Jesus, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other answered, rebuking him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. And then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. That's called grace. It's like there is nothing that he did in the past to deserve favor from God. Matter of fact, just the opposite under law. He even, of his own admission, this is what I deserve. But God, just because through faith alone, by grace, through faith alone, can you remember me? I tell you today, wow, that's power. Can you imagine if Moses' generation and the Exodus generation got together and they believed in that kind of grace from God for us, through us, to a world that needs to see by their love, you shall know. Can you imagine? I ask that God would help us to stop striving and performing and pointing, and start receiving from him what we say we are. And if we are, then it goes out to one generation, one people, one church. That's how it'll be in heaven. That's what brings revival, is when heaven comes to earth and manifests what heaven is on earth with that kind of grace and love. We can settle for the 30-fold if we want and have little pop-pouring compartments, expressions of the kingdom. We can do that, or we can see a remnant of an outpouring of a spirit in the last days where we drink in freely what comes from God. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy. That's not getting what you deserve. That we may obtain mercy and find grace, our charis. Who wants to be a charismatic? And find grace to help in time of need. Man, Church of Jesus Christ, we need help. It's something how history has a tendency to repeat itself. We need another Jesus revolution. We need old, middle, and young, and wet behind the ears to all come together and say, we're looking to the same Savior. for the same grace that is sufficient for all of us in our weakness right where we are at. And we're going to be intentional about walking in that. In Jesus' name. Stand to your feet, saints of God. If there's anyone here today that is questioning still whether you can receive the grace, power, favor, provision of God, consider this as the closing word for today. Romans 8. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? When we look to the rock that is struck, the invitation ultimately is to say, Father, thank you for loving me enough to give your one and only son. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever would believe that he was struck for you and for me to be reunited to the Father, no longer will Moses walk around like an orphan, though he thought he was. No longer will a generation who never had family night as slaves will walk around like an orphan, though they were. We'll all say, we got one Father, and we're one generation. And I can come before God and ask anything from him that is good because he's given his best. What would he withhold from me?